Tonight's edition of Arizona ArtBeat takes us more than 200,000 miles away from Earth to the surface of the moon. Lunar Landscapes is a photographic exhibition that opens tomorrow at the monOrchid Gallery in downtown Phoenix. We were there now yesterday as the show was being assembled. It consists of dozens of images taken by NASA's Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter Camera, or LROC. The high-quality images show prominent features of the lunar landscape. Talking impact craters, ancient lava flows, and the landing sites where Apollo astronauts once walked on the moon. They're all captured in stunning detail. ASU Professor Mark Robinson calls the shots for cameras aboard Orbiter. The LROC was launched into space a few years ago on a fact-finding mission to help facilitate putting humans back on the moon. Joining me now to talk about the Lunar Landscapes exhibition is Mark Robinson, professor at ASU School of Earth and Space Exploration. He's LROC's principal investigator and curator of Lunar Landscapes exhibition. Good to see you again. Did you ever think you'd be a curator of an art exhibit?
I didn't know I was.
Congratulations.
I like the title, yeah.
Yeah. The thought behind this particular exhibit.
Well, the thought behind the exhibit is to get people who don't normally interact with the science community or come down to ASU campus or go to professional meetings or even go to our webpage to see the moon. I mean, we've got this fantastic mission of exploration. It's been in orbit around the moon since June of 2009. And every day we return 450 gigabits of fantastic images of the surface of the moon. And the moon is an incredibly exciting place. It's beautiful, it's mysterious, not only scientifically, but just aesthetically. Mountain ranges. You did a great intro, actually. I even got more excited about it from listening to you, right? And we take these pictures, and they come down, and, you know, everybody on the team has engineering purposes or science purposes, but you just can't help to be excited about the landscapes we're seeing. I mean, a lot of these images, nobody has ever seen these landscapes before.
Well, they are stunning, and I want to take a look at some of them here real quickly, including this first one. And it's interesting. It's literally a west to east view of the Tycho crater. I mean, you're down. You know exactly where it's at, and what it's doing up there, don't you?
Yeah,
that's an amazing. Talk to us about that image and what can learn.
Okay,
from that.
Well, Tycho crater is about 82 kilometers in diameter, so that's. I'll have to translate it. 50 miles.
Sure.
That central peak in the middle is about 50 kilometers across or 10 miles, and it's 2,000 meters or 6,000 feet high. That's a big mountain, okay?
Yes.
But very, unlike mountains on the Earth, all this topography was formed in a few seconds. And that's when an asteroid that was maybe 10 kilometers in diameter slammed into the moon at 20 kilometers a second. And just, you know, those forces are so outside of our normal experience.
How big would that have to be again?
10 kilometers.
That's it.
Something like that.
And this may make something like that.
Yeah.
My goodness.
And the peak was formed in a matter of seconds. Now, again, it's a 6,000-foot high mountain, and that formed in a few seconds. And see how it looks almost like sea ice around it?
Yes.
That is frozen melt, because there was so much energy released in the impact that the lunar surface melted right there.
My goodness.
It pooled. And if you come down to the show, you'll be able to see some of these impact melt flows in incredible detail down to the meter scale.
And now there's another photograph of another crater. This apparently is a young crater, I think. It's certainly the images of this one, again, they're striking. We're seeing things that almost look like artist renditions. What about this particular crater?
Okay, yeah, this is one of my favorite. It's Linnae crater. It's about 2.5 kilometers in diameter. So if you've ever been to meteor crater,
yes.
This is about twice as big, and it's about twice as deep. It's 500 meters deep, so it's 1,500 feet deep. And if you, I don't know if you can zoom all the way down here on the screen.
Well, we'll give it our best shot here, but I'm not sure. There we
okay.
go.
As you get down closer and closer, you can actually see boulders that have streamed down the side and were thrown out at the edge. But if you look very closely, see there's some dark materials and then some bright materials. Now imagine if you're going to the moon with either a rover or you as an astronaut, and you could plan out with these kind of images exactly where you wanted to go sample the different types of rocks, because the black rocks are black for a reason. They're more mafic, probably. They have more iron in them. The white rocks may have less iron in them, maybe more north acidic. So that's one of the major goals of this whole mission, is to help NASA map out most interesting places to go, and what to do when we get there.
There really is a colonization aspect to all this, isn't there?
Maybe colonization is down the road. Let's get back to the moon first.
Sure.
Okay? It's been 40 years since we were at the moon, right? NASA has had a a plan and a goal to get back to the moon about 5 or 6 years ago, and that's the LRO is part of that. You know, due to the fiscal situation and so on and so forth, those plans are somewhat on hold right now. But economy's getting better, we're coming back. We've got this fantastic data. We know where to go now. We have all this great data from Apollo days, this new information from Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter. And now we know there's a lot of resources on the moon. So it's not purely to go back for science. It's to get resources and to help us to learn how to work in space so we can go beyond the moon into Mars. I mean, I'd love to go to Mars. How about you?
I think so.
But to get there first, we've got to learn how to work on another body. And we want to do that. We're only 3.5 days away from the Earth.
Do you think that with all the attention to the Mars rovers and these sorts of things, that the moon has been kind of forgotten here in recent years?
Well, the moon doesn't get quite as much publicity as Mars does. And I think that's, you know, there's several reasons. One, you know, the Apollo astronauts went there. We brought rocks back. And the moon is close, and it's similar, right? And it's like you live in Phoenix. How often do you go to particular, like the Meteor Crater or Grand Canyon? You do it when out-of-town visitors come. Mars is a bit sexier. It's far away. And people like to think about the possibility of life on Mars in the past, right? There isn't much possibility there's ever life on the moon. You know, the moon has a vacuum. There's no atmosphere. But there's incredible geology to be had. There's incredible sites to be had.
And
there's resources.
Oh, no kidding. And you mentioned, you know, there once was life on the moon. We had some astronauts up there. And
that's
one of
true.
Your photographs in this exhibition shows what Apollo 11, where it landed, and the debris up there, the detritus of the landing, correct?
Yeah, this is a great image. I love these pictures of the landing sites. You see right in the center that very bright circular feature, that's the bottom stage of the lunar module. That's what served as a launch pad. So it's still sitting there.
It's still there.
And if you look to the south or below that, you see those little other bright spots?
Yes.
That's a retroreflector where we still shoot lasers at that so we can measure the distance to the moon to centimeter accuracy. There's a seismometer that lasted for 3 or 4 months and sent data back. And see to the right, that impact crater?
Yeah.
And that faint black line over there? Those are Neil Armstrong's tracks. And he had a few minutes left after they got done setting up those experiments. And as he was landing, he noticed that he went right over that crater. And he thought, I bet those geologists would love to have a picture inside that an impact crater. So he ran over there out of the view of the camera, took the pictures, and nobody knew on the ground, right, that he did that. And then you could see where he went back to the,
oh my goodness,
the lunar module. And he was a great scientist, even though he was an engineer, because he collected probably, you know, one of the most fantastic sample collections in a few minutes, and he went over there and took the picture of the crater.
This is great stuff. Again, monOrchid Gallery, downtown Phoenix, correct, through the month, something along those lines?
Yeah.
I think we're going to have more information here in a second.
And every Friday night, if you come down there between 6 and 10 o'clock, there'll be special tours, but it's open all week, so please come down.
Very good. Congratulations. Sounds like a great exhibit. Good to have you here. And you can visit the surface of the moon starting tomorrow when Lunar Landscapes opens at monOrchid Gallery during the first Friday art walk in downtown Phoenix. The show will remain open through the end of November.